my corner.
Hi, my name is Penn, and this is my partner, Teller. I am 1 foot taller than Teller. I have been for 10 years, and I always will be. Some things never change. But we're professional liars. We like to fool people, trick their eyes, cheat them, swindle them. This whole room is a trick, and we're not going to tell you how it's done. This show is about how artists use paintings and drawings to trick your eye. Like how they'll make something look way off in the distance when you know it's just flat on a piece of paper hanging right on your wall. Or how they'll take things that you know have depth, that you know are three-dimensional, and make them look flat as a pancake. In this show, we're going to give away all the artist's secrets.
These houses all look flat. Those quilters had the knack.
I can't see any room for rooms. The front door's in the back.
These houses start out flat, but then there's depth I like. You'd like to stroll back to those hills.
I'd rather take my bike.
Flat as the paint on the walls of your bedroom. As a field that goes back to the sunset.
I've hit a baseball way deeper than that.
The artist made these dancers flat so he could catch your eye.
Well, maybe so, but two of them are floating in the sky.
This game of snap the whip has started flat, you'll find. But look, that last boy's pretty deep.
But flat on his behind.
Flat as the paint on the walls of your bedroom.
Flat as the grass where a hippo has sat.
Deep as a field that goes back to the sunset.
I've made a cat jump farther than
geometric shapes that all have finally met.
Not geometric shapes, oh please, I can't do fractions yet.
Here's one with shapes, but look how deep into the back you sink. There's space back there you could explore.
My spaceship's on the blink.
Flat is just surface deep, let your eye in.
Artists do a lot of tricks with their paintings. That's not one of them. That's a swindler doing a trick with his sleeve. But all this flat and deep stuff, I don't get it. Why don't they just paint flat things flat and deep things deep? Well, I'll tell you why. Because they don't just see, they also think. And they like to surprise you, and they also like to surprise themselves. We're going to see a painter, David Hockney, painting during this show. And he really likes to shake things up. He really likes to destroy your expectations.
Maybe it was Wacky Wednesday for him. He just wanted to draw something that really looked crazy.
He couldn't probably see too good.
It looked like a big fat man sat on a chair and he squashed it.
You'd expect an artist to draw a chair right, wouldn't you? Okay, chill down, relax. Maybe you'll be able to figure out what Hockney thinks about when he makes these pictures.
Well, there's a simple drawing of the chair made from me standing still, like the camera. What I'm trying to get at, though, is we're so used to looking at pictures where The viewpoint is fixed. The artist, like the cameraman, stood still. We begin to think everything looks that way, don't we? But it's actually very unlike the way we see, because our lives are all about movement. We want movement. Now, if I walk round the chair and then think of what I saw, this seems to me would make it more real. It's got a very round back. I can see that going over there from that side. And then you could swing it back here and see it from this side as well. Now, this shape where you sit would come round here. It could also come round here, so I'm now at this side. And as you see, what happens is the shape of the chair all begins to change. That side. Anyway, what we're finishing up with, well, you think, ah, this looks like a chair. This looks like a distorted chair. You couldn't actually sit in it, you think. Well, what was all that we saw? As I walked around the chair, the shapes were changing all the time. Can I find one shape that would seem to put all this together? Well, slowly, you can make up another kind of picture that's equally real as the other picture. Now, I'll just carry on with this drawing.
Do you get it? He's not drawing a chair. He's drawing a walk around a chair. How would you draw a walk around a chair, putting all the things you saw into one picture?
David Hockney has his own way of looking at things, and therefore his own way of painting them on canvas or on paper. Meanwhile, back in the studio, we're going to give you a few of the tricks for creating the illusion of depth, even though everything's on a flat surface. How do you make a person or an animal or a thing seem far back in the distance when you know perfectly well it's on a flat, 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 flat surface? Well, one of the ways is size. Things that are closer to you look bigger. Things that are further away look smaller. We've got some twins here, two identical twins. They usually come in twos, these twins. And you're absolutely identical, is that right?
Uh-huh.
And I know that your names are Dawn and Debbie, and I don't know which one. I think you're Debbie.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Right? And you're Dawn. Uh-huh. Now, I don't believe this. I don't believe that you two people can be absolutely identical. I don't think there's no way that can happen.
You're absolutely identical.
Absolutely identical.
Absolutely.
Because it looks to me like Debbie is considerably taller than Dawn. Is that right?
Nope. We're both the same size.
You're both the same height? Because it looks to me like you're shorter and you are taller, is that right? But you're telling me, no? Okay, now let me get this right. Now, you look shorter to me now, Debbie. You're a little bit shorter, and Dawn is a little bit taller.
We're the same height.
You're not the same height. I'm looking at the monitor, kid, and you are different heights. I'll tell you that right now. That Debbie is considerably smaller than Dawn, and Dawn is considerably taller. And I'll tell you why, because we're pushing these platforms back and forth, and that Debbie is getting taller because you're being pushed closer and back, and we're cheating, aren't we?
Yeah!
So, size is important. Little things are far away, and big things are up close. Another trick that artists use to make things look deep is overlap. They play on something that you take for granted. That when something is in front of something else, the thing that's in front covers up part of the thing that's in back. You can't see all of the thing that's in back.
And that's not overlap, that's a swindle. Let's see how overlap works in the real world. Okay, who's in front? Tatiana or Mark? You can't tell, can you? But Mark, my man, scoot in toward me. See that? You know he's behind Tatiana because you can't even see him. Stick your head out, Mark. See, you can tell which one's behind by which one you can't see all of. Let's bring someone else in. DMC, my man, come on in. Boom, we see that he is in front of Tatiana. And Ronnie is in front of them. And come on in, Young. See if you can see where he's going to fit. And the rest of you, scoot on in. Come on, Latoya, Maria, Allison. I want you to do something, guys. See that TV camera right there? Make sure you can all be seen. And you people at home, you can tell who's in front by how much you see of them. You're going to see all of Ronnie, and you're going to see very little of Allison. See? When you can't see all of something, that's the thing that's behind. Providing, of course, you know what that thing looks like. That's overlap for you. Here's another trick that artists use. What's wrong with this picture? No, it's not the ram and the apple tree and the sun are cardboard. And it's not that the grass is plastic. Nowadays, most grass is plastic. It's not even that two usually smooth guys like us are standing like jerks. What's wrong with this picture is I look the same size as him. And we know he's a shrimp. We know I'm bigger than him. But he is closer to you. But you couldn't tell that because you couldn't see the ground. You couldn't see how far away from the camera I was. You can't tell distance until you can see the ground. If you want to know how far away something is, look at the ground.
I'm a graphic artist. My name is Marilyn Ono, and I use the computer screen, which is a very flat surface, the way other artists use a piece of paper or a canvas or maybe a wall even. I can do many things that the computer can't do, but there's some things that the computer can help me do much better and much faster. For instance, it can make, I'll show you here, it helps me make very, very straight lines without using a ruler. Of course, I always have to tell the computer what to do. I have to make all the decisions and do all the thinking. It's just my instrument. Just the way any painter can do, I can use my computer to create the illusion of depth. Let's make more ground. The line where the ground meets the sky is called the horizon line. Let's put a giraffe in our picture. There. Now, another giraffe. You can see they're exactly the same size. But because things closest to the horizon line look like they're farther away from us, if I put the giraffe closer to the horizon line, it looks like it's farther away. And if I make it smaller, it looks like it's even farther away. Let's put another giraffe the same size and we'll overlap them. We'll take another giraffe. Let's put it very close to the horizon line. There are a lot of animals that fit in one space. It looks like you could see a mile. Ooh,
Oh!
I'm pointing out, sir, about the floorboards. Now, which direction do the floorboards go in? If we film the floorboards, if you give me the camera, I would show you what would happen. Now, here you are, you're just looking at my feet, and the floorboards are going straight across the picture. But if I turn this way now, they're going at another angle. Now, each of the angle changes represent a movement. And so what direction are the floorboards going in does depend on what position you're in. So if you move and go in all positions, then they go in all directions. So you could draw them going in all directions, and this would represent us moving. That might be one angle. Then, but if I've moved now, they're going at another angle. Now they're going up here. Now they're doing that. Then they might be doing that. Or then they're doing that. Or then they're doing that. Then they're doing that. All angles can go in, and then you begin to see that the floor would relate to movement. Now, when you start drawing it, that movement, in a sense, makes space. So if I carry on with my drawing, well, of course, you were seeing, when you were seeing me drawing from this side, of course, I could see an eye looking at me with a camera and a man wheeling it around, which is why it moved, so I drew it in as well. That is representing you, anyway. I'm only trying to take note of everything that happens in space and put it in. And I'm trying to put in the whole experience of looking at the chair, walking around the chair, drawing the chair as I'm drawing it. It's also taking time. This man looking at me all the time with this weird black eye. So you put that in as well. And so you can see what it looks like to me. That's what I'm doing.
Here we have some grass and a sky. Let's put a road in this picture. Around the beginning of the 15th century in Europe, during a time called the Renaissance, people saw that even though a road is actually made of two lines that are the same distance apart from each other, the lines seem to come together as the road goes off into the distance. And they meet at a point on the horizon line called the vanishing point. Artists developed a whole system around this idea, and it's called perspective. This system allowed them to organize all the things in their pictures. Painters were fascinated with perspective and used it to make their pictures look very deep.
What's this, Aldo? What are you trying to do?
Oh, I'm trying to draw a doghouse, Eddie, but I can't seem to make it work.
Well, no wonder, Aldo. For a doghouse, you have to have a space to put it in.
Oh? Like what?
First, you need a horizon line.
A horizon line?
So you'll have some ground to put your doghouse on.
Uh-huh.
Now, where would you want it?
I want it right here. Where do you think I want it?
Okay. You sit right there. I'll be right back.
Eddie, where are you? You've almost vanished.
Right. I'm putting a vanishing point on the horizon line, as near this edge as I can. And now I'm drawing perspective lines from the vanishing point to the place where you want to put your doghouse.
You better hurry, Eddie. It's gonna rain. Hey!
Take it easy. I need another vanishing point.
Hey, Eddie, I can see where my house is going to be. Okay, but I think it's going to need a roof right away.
Wait a minute. The first thing you're going to need is a foundation. And you've got to decide what kind of a house you want.
Oh, well, I want something about this high and kind of fancy maybe, huh? Like a Greek temple. Or the Egyptian pyramids.
Mm.
Or like the Colosseum in Rome. How about a Gothic cathedral? Or a skyscraper?
Shut up, Aldo. I've got to think about it. What you need is a framework with strong studs.
Hurry!
And a pitched roof, a door in front.
And my name above the door.
And some trees in front of the house. And a storm to go away. And some mountains in the distance.
Oh, I like that.
And a road. And a fence.
And a new car to drive on the road. Eddie, I think we're also going to need a driveway and a garage and a guest room for the chauffeur and all...
Hold it, Aldo. Hold it. Here, take your pencil. Now you can draw it all by yourself.
I'll stop on this drawing now.
It's very real.
Very real. It's a very real crayon drawing. But what you're seeing is, of course, a television photograph. A real television picture of a drawing made on paper. There's many different ways you can actually look at the world, and we now tend to think the world does look
like the television camera shows us, but you've just to start thinking a bit and seeing it differently, thinking how you see.
Looks like a memory that he had, and he drew it.
It's pretty neat. It's all different views bunched up together.
And, yeah, it's the floor. It's on like roads. Roads to different directions of the room.
It's sort of flat, but the chair jumps out.
Sometimes you can say it's deep and flat.
I don't know. Those artists, man, those guys, they'll do anything they can just to mess with you. You know, they just change any way you think about space. Got it? I'm Penn. This is Teller. Stay fresh.
Chairs change their shapes wherever you're standing. You see the chair in a different way. It's part of the game that artists are playing.
Hi, I'm Penn, and my partner Teller is around here somewhere. We're Penn and Teller, and we're here to talk about line. First, what is a line? Well, it's a trail, the record of a movement. Now, you think of line as having length, of course, but a line has width, too. And lines don't have to be straight. They can curve and wind around and do a lot of stuff. Anyway, there are many, many different kinds of line.
Thank you.
most important ways that artists use line in their paintings and drawings is to outline, describe a shape. Often an outline is all you need to see to know what an object is.
We'll show you an outline. You tell us what it is.
A drop of water on the surface.
A sunrise.
They're putting a quarter into a machine, like a video game machine.
It looks like a ship about to hit an iceberg.
A witch is drowning and the boat's too late to save her.
A path leading to a house with four bushes on the side of the path.
It looks like a bear climbing up a telephone pole.
The last pieces of corn on a cob.
A pinwheel, and when the wind comes, they blow.
Four elephant trunks trying to get the same peanut.
I've lined up someone to help us, Wayne Thiebaud, the artist on this show. Wayne Thiebaud, who began his career drawing cartoons and comic strips and went on to become one of our great American painters, is beginning a drawing with an outline.
The definition of a line actually for me is it's a dot that moves. And that's what this is. So you make, let's say, an outline of something you're going to do. It's the kind of structure that holds the form together. It's like the skeleton of the body. It gets out of adjustment all the time, but you keep remembering this basic original structure. If you think then of a line that represents what's called a shadow core. This shadow core will become the dividing line between light and dark. And you begin to shade this side of the shadow core. Right here, this is a cast shadow, and it's darkest where the ice cream cone is blocking the light. The lines keep being the kind of guide all the time. I go back and I'll make this line or line around an edge. It's like a road map. So that this little world you're trying to make is supposed to be a kind of world of its own, where you're responsible for the entire surface of it.
One way artists use line is to make shadows. Shadows can be made by cross-hatching or by drawing lines very close together.
The little shadows that you see on our faces and clothes give a feeling of roundness or volume.
Hi, I'm Marilyn Ono, and I use the computer to make pictures. Here's an outline of a pear, and I'll make another one. When you look at just an outline, the object looks very flat. But if you shade it, you get a sense of its roundness, and you get a lot more information about the object. But how do I know where to put the shading? In order to put in your shadows, you have to know where the light's coming from. So I put my shadows on the side of the object that's furthest away from the light. If the object is blocking the light, it casts a shadow. Let's move the light and see what happens.
So you see, if you want to create roundness, you have to draw shadows, and you have to know where the light is coming from.
I'm using the line, reworking it to show the volume. The roundness of the ice cream. You're trying to build clues and information which lets people feel the space. And what you do then is sort of get rid of line, soften it, fill it in to create this illusion of roundness. You don't really get rid of the line, but you make it less noticeable, so the ice cream cone looks rounder, more real. What I'm trying to do is draw something that looks round and yet at the same time show that it's on a flat piece of paper. In a way, the painters I admire are the ones that deal simultaneously with both roundness and illusion, but always remind you that it's a painting that is on a surface.
A line can be a circle, all you have to do is twirl it. That circle can fly away, just take that line and hurl it. A line can take any shape, embody any notion. A line can be a record of a motion. You can step inside a line, in which case it's outside you. Stepping out is easy too, a line's too small to hide you. In and out and roundabout, the motions you're combining just show you what that moving line's defining. Take a line, any line, make a moving circle and combine. High or low, fast or slow, you make a line no matter where you go. A line can be wiggly, as if a snake just drew it. A line can be squiggly, as if a storm blew through it. A line can take any shape, embody any notion. A line can be a record of a motion. Take some twine, rope is fine. Make a moving circle, what a line. Up to you, what to do. The secret's in the wrist, just follow through. Hang it loose, it's a noose. There are many ways to put a noose to use. Got my hat, guess that's that. Your turn to learn to use a lariat.
Hi, I'm Matt Groening, and I created this little guy. You might recognize him. That's right, America's favorite Bart Simpson. I've been drawing this way since I was a little kid. So, a piece of advice that I have for you all is, if you do some drawings, save them. Because I guarantee, at some point later in your life, you want to look at them and see what kind of kid you were. So we all know the Battle Hymn of the Republic and the, you know, the variation lyrics. The lyrics, I hope you know, because these are the lyrics that I grew up with in school. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the burning of the school. We have tortured all the teachers. We have broken every rule. We have barbecued the principal, destroyed the PTA. Us kids go marching on.
Right.
What I want to do is I want to have Bongo, the one-eared rabbit, sing all this and then get to school and look like a little angel. And what I do is I draw these humanoid animals, and I try to draw long, curvy lines, and try to draw as few lines as possible. And the reader of the cartoon strip will assign motion to these characters. Another way of doing it is to add motion lines, like this conveys a sort of a quivering. And I'll just do that in this particular drawing. And let's make him so he's hopping. So we'll put little hop lines right here, and then a kind of a little bang line where his foot has hit the ground. There. Okay, now, how do we indicate that he's really moving? We'll put different backgrounds on each one. We'll start over here because, like I said, I don't want to smear the drawing. So, I'll put the horizon, let's put it right here. Draw a line through there. And I like to keep it simple, just like I drew. This is more like how I drew in the first grade. Let's draw a little house here. My cartooning style is based on the fifth grade, but my background design is based on the first grade. Okay, so there's a little house. I'll put a fence here. And I like to draw the sun and little birds. Now, let's say he's running down a hill, so this will be very simple. I'll do like that. Put some gravel and a cloud, the sun, and a couple of birds. Now here, some jittery lines to indicate both speed and quivering. He's running through town now. So we'll do a buildings in the background. And as you can see,
You don't have to do very many lines to indicate a place. One of the reasons why I like cartooning is because it's like shorthand in a way. You can convey things with very, very few lines. Now, the ground down here. I'll put little L's for windows. And that's not enough motion lines, so let's give them some motion lines here. There we go. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the burning of the school. We have tortured all the teachers. We have broken every rule. We have barbecued the principal, destroyed the PTA. Us kids go marching on. Another cartoonist gets away with murder.
Artists who make drawings and paintings suggest motion by using lines, just like cartoonists do.
Okay, so you can use line to create a sense of motion.
Artists use line in many different ways and for many different reasons, sometimes to express a mood or a feeling.
Lines can express a lot of different emotions. They can make you feel calm and relaxed, or anxious or tense. How does this make you feel? And how about this one?
If you go back now and rework that line that was there, back and forth, you feel the roundness of the cone. Somehow the line is lost, but in fact, you've used the line all the way along. And if you want something to look round, you have to imitate the light and how light forms itself over any kind of object. There's no other way to do it. For instance, this is called a highlight because it's the highest light on the object. So the ice cream cone for me represents kind of joy, the sort of temporariness. It's here and very fresh, firm. That very bright spirit that it once had, kind of color, light, liveliness, soon will be gone. Now maybe we'll be able to fix it. Oh, I'll take it outside. Let's see now. This fixative is what keeps the chalk from smudging. And when it dries, the color will go back to the way it was.
If you've been following our storyline, you now know that lines come in many different shapes and forms, and that artists use them in all sorts of combinations to show you what they think and see. And that's not just another line.
Mm-hmm. Ha! Mm-hmm.
Hi, I'm Penn, and this is my partner, Teller. We're Penn and Teller, and we're here to tell you something about art and how artists like to surprise you, mess with your head, and puzzle your eye with color.
Wardrobe, wait a minute. Where's the costume designer? These suits are supposed to be the same color. We always dress in the same color.
They are the same color.
No. Anyone can see they're not. Mine is pink, and Teller's is purple. Oh, wait a minute. Okay, now my suit looks purple, and Teller's is pink.
They're exactly the same color.
Wardrobe!
Do you get it? These two dots are the same color, but the colors look different depending on what colors are around them.
Like I said, colors can easily fool you because they don't stay the same. Yeah, sure. That was a cheap gag. But artists also know that colors can be used to fool your eye. You can do anything you want with color. There are no color police.
What color is water? A drop isn't any. The thing about water drops when you have many is there's a blue ocean. But when oceans get mean, they make you seasick. You could color them green. I'd rather color them yellow or pink. I like my oceans exciting, I think. I'll color it. There's more than one way I can color it. So much I can say when I color it. Any color I lay on with fingers or crayon is fine. What I color is mine. The thing that I've noticed the most about trees is they shimmer in colors when blown by the breezes. On very still mornings, trees have nothing to do. That's when I wonder if they're feeling blue. Maybe that's what I like best about trees. I know they can be any color I please. The sky is like water, but lighter, more airy, more big than an ocean, and sometimes more scary when angry and stormy and moving toward night. I like it most when it's sunny and bright. I'll put in some clouds sailing puffy and proud. At sunset there's nothing as loud as a cloud. I'll color it. There's more than one way I can color it. So much I can say when I color it. Any color I lay on with fingers or crayon is fine. What I color is mine.
What we usually think of as the color of a thing, like the pink of our faces or the white of our suits, is actually the color that we seem to be in daylight. Like this. But the color of daylight changes throughout the day. Colors look way, way different at sunset, for example. Well, how about twilight? Dusk. In this program, we're going to see a wonderful artist, Robert Hilda Montez, who was born in Mexico but now lives in Los Angeles. You can see he loves to play with color, and we're going to follow him as he paints a picture and try to see where his ideas come from.
I'm mostly attracted to color, I think, when I see them all together. I think of my own history and how the Aztecs used to have all these beautiful gardens and how they took care of so many flowers. It almost looked like a brush stroke. I think what's important to me is that I see a lot of color. So I think somehow I absorb it. This is my work. The very beginning is to cover the canvas with color. I cannot make any decisions until I make a mark. I cannot say this is the wrong color. The most important thing was to put the paint on the canvas. I didn't know what I was going to do with it. And I still don't. I don't think it's necessary to know what you're going to do. I decided on a couple of colors and where the colors come from. It could be from anywhere. I decided they would be from flowers. So it's simple enough. I'm concerned that the whole area develops at the same time. I could have started with the face, but I worked on the whole canvas. Aside from the face, I work on the whole canvas evenly. Some of the colors came from the flowers directly. Some of them were just a starting point. Some of them from memory. When I grew up in Mexico, the living room walls were two purple ones, and the other ones were Mexican pink. There were things that were guiding me, but I'm still not sure what it is. I didn't like the arms. I took them out. Yes, I wanted to have wings instead of arms. Right now, they look like they're part of something else, but Tomorrow they'll look like they belong in the figure.
Hi, I'm Marilyn Ono, and I use the computer to make pictures. Today we're going to talk a little bit about color. You can see I have a large variety of colors. You might be wondering where all these colors come from. They actually are all made by mixing three colors together. Red, yellow, and blue. Now these patches of color look like solid color here, but actually on the computer, they're made up of tiny squares so small and so close together you can't even see them. But if you could see them, they'd probably look something like this. Now, let's suppose we wanted to make the color orange. Since orange doesn't have any blue in it, we'll get rid of the blue. And the red mixes with the yellow. If you shrink it down, it looks like orange. Here's a picture of a lion. But if you look really closely, you begin to see that there are many different colors that make up the lion. There's brown and yellow and green. And when you look at it at a distance, your eye mixes all those colors together to create the tannish color of the lion. This lion looks a little lonely, so let's make a picture. First, let's add another lion. Maybe we'll also add a tree. Next, let's put in a ground. And then we'll add a sky. This picture looks very odd. Just imagine a world with only one color. That's what makes it look so flat. Color can make a picture have depth. If I make the sky blue, and then we'll make the grass green, already it has more depth.
Now, what are some of the things that artists can do with color in their paintings? Well, one thing is that they can use color to make things look flat and deep. How does that work? Well, artists studied colors and noticed that bright colors appear to come forward and that hazy, pale, and bluish colors seem to go back. Here's how it works. Say you got a tree on top of a hill, like this one. Now, if you want to make that tree look far away, you can't draw it in the same color, the same bright green. Watch. Okay, now I'm driving off into the slightly bluish gray hazy hills. Now that we're a little further away, you can see that the two trees are no longer the same color. So if you want something to look further away, one thing you can do is paint it hazier, paler colors. Cut! Here's another thing that artists do with color. Now, what's the most important thing in this picture? Well, you might be looking at this motorcycle, but your friend might be looking at this lawnmower. Well, another way that artists use color is to lead your eye into looking where they want you to look. They use color to direct you towards what is the most important thing in a picture. You see, now, this picture is about that little football. And now the whole picture changes and becomes about that very attractive straw hat.
And artists also use color to tell you that you should think of certain things in the picture as connected to one another, like the boxing gloves and the sneakers. Or our lovely yellow scuba ensemble, consisting of the mask, the snorkel, the tank, and the fins. So artists use color to tell you where to look, what's important in the picture, and also what things they want you to connect in a picture.
In this picture, there's two lions, and they look like they might be related in some way. Maybe they're part of the same family or part of the same team. But if I change the color of one, now they look like they're not on the same team anymore. And if I add some more pink lions in the background, your eye goes from one pink lion to the next, and it makes you think that those pink lions are connected in some way. What does it make you think about the yellow lion? Now let's make the pink lions in the distance yellow. How do you think the story has changed?
Curious cricket, it's a story of connections. The bat with the ball and the ball with the cricket, for whom it was a ticket to adventure space. A place where nice to meet you, shall we play? Becomes I'd like to eat you, that makes it time to run away. To a cricket in the grass, butterflies flying past, don't make any connections. In a story of connections, some are good, some are bad, this one's bad for the cricket, who's a fine meal ticket for a hungry toad, whose tongue says nice to meet you, stick around, I'd really like to eat you. The cricket took off with a bound. Here's a cricket on the run, you could say, who has won, very serious problem, but in the story of connections, the girl with the bats on the ball and the cricket finds out she's his ticket for a getaway. Bye-bye.
I'm gonna put the arms back on. Arms and wings. I didn't like the arms, I took them out. I put wings instead of arms, and then I had a chance to think about it, and I said, wings and arms together are better than just wings. That I kind of want to lift them off the ground, because you can't have wings and be like this. As I started working on all the other areas, I kept on seeing that it was too grounded. There was something so rigid about being sideways, and I wanted the figure to float. The wings were something that is going to lift me off, but it's also something that sees. Spooky.
Ah.
blue face came when I, before I started painting, I had blue on my face. And everybody said, "You have blue in your face?" And I thought, that's the color I'll paint the face. So that's where that came from. It didn't come from the flower. It came from an experience. I think.
Cows aren't bright yellow, and children don't have blue or red faces. So what are these artists getting at?
Let's do something different. Let's change the color of the sky. Artists use color in many different ways and for many different reasons. Sometimes to give a sense of place or to express a mood or a feeling. So the same painting might feel completely different with different colors.
Artists choose not to paint figures at all, but to use color for its own sake. These paintings are mainly about color.
At this stage on the painting, I have to make a decision on the light. Like, where is the light coming from in the painting? And that becomes a little bit critical at this point. I have to think more than just express myself with the color. For the highlights are going to be, I need to mix those colors with white. Because where the light hits a color, it becomes a little bit lighter. That will be the highlight. That's what really gives it its dimension, you know, that it has all the highlights and all the shadows. I'm putting this yellows, like if there's also a yellow light hitting the subject. Supposed to be smoke rings. I wanted them to lift off, and I thought, when you see people throw a smoke ring, the thing floats, and the wings float, and it was just another element to help me elevate it. Not a real person. I don't want it to be a real person. It has yellow hands, blue face, purple body, wings. It could be a person that is in front of an audience. It could be a costume. It could be a dream. I think it's me. Not me as you see me, but some aspect of myself. Somewhat off the ground, kind of trying to take off.
So artists use color to make you make connections, to make you see something as flat or deep, or just to have fun with it. They use color to express the way they feel about the world and to change how you see it. Now, our suits look like they're different colors, don't they? Well, they look that way not because they're against different backgrounds, but because we're cheating. So long.
Ah. Ooh.